So, good afternoon, everybody. It gives me immense pleasure to be present among such a distinguished panel and moderate on a very critical topic. It is very important in this scenario. We are traveling in a zone which we have not seen, not estimated, not ever forecasted, the COVID zone. And it is very important to bring in the dynamism in the whole of the business processes. I have very esteemed panel who are heading their organization in their own respective way, and they are really bringing in this dynamism into the organization to pass this troubled, crisis-ridden era, and which is creating a new challenges on day-to-day basis. So I may introduce, first of all, Mr. Mohit Shukla. Mohit is the Managing Director and Head India Legal and Regulatory and Government Relations for Barclays. Mohit is having over 20 years of work experience with a diverse background, including the metals manufacturing, tobacco and hospitality industries, prior to financial services, first with the Angel Group, Citigroup as General Counsel, South Asia, and then Barclays. Welcome, Mohit. Thank you for taking our time to come into the show. I'm sure we all are going to be benefited by your experience. Then our next panelist is Anubhav. Anubhav Kapoor is a Group Vice President and Group Company Secretary for Cummins Group in India. And this is a very dual kind of a role he is into, and which is very relevant in today's world, today's COVID world, I would say, because today we are going to discuss a lot of board issues and the director's risk mitigation strategies. Definitely being a company secretary, he must be part of those strategies. And we are also going to discuss some legal leadership. So he must be taking care of the regulatory framework at the same time and informing, guiding to the board that which way we should travel and which path we should travel in these troubled times. Then we have Debolina. Debolina brings in the different kind of experience into this panel, because the corona crisis is not affecting everybody in the same way. The corona crisis is affecting a different organization, different companies differently. Today, we are mostly focusing on the business organization strategy within the legal leadership framework. So it's wonderful to have Debolina here, because Debolina worked for the Wockhardt, and she is a GC and the Vice President Legal. And definitely the issue of continuity is there with the other organization. But at the same time, for the pharmaceutical organization, they have a greater responsibility to save lives. And definitely there is a larger role for them on the fore. So definitely their strategy is not going to be defensive, I think, and Debolina is going to put light on this. Their strategy within the regulatory framework must be to serve the nation better. And definitely the organization has to pull up their socks to run more in these times. Then we have Jitender Jagota. Jitender is a Director, Legal and Government Affairs and Company Secretary for Avon. And Jitender is going to put some light on the regulatory framework, the desire of the organization, how organizations should move to the government, and how they should be able to reach to the government if they require anything in protocol within the regime to help the organization to pass the test of the corona, I would say. Thank you very much, Jitender. Thank you, Debolina, to come on the show. And then our last panelist, but not the least, because he moves the earth. He works for the Tata Consulting Engineering Limited. Sachin Mishra. Sachin is the head and legal company secretary. So Sachin is also having a variety of the experience on the how the corporates are strategizing themselves for the COVID. And at the same time, Sachin is also making a bridge between the present legal framework and the board decision-making process to deal with corona, because nothing can be important than dealing the corona crisis within the regulatory framework, and that's how the legal leadership is also very important. Thank you, Sachin, for coming on this panel. Thank you very much. Most welcome, Sachin.
Thank you, Manoj. Thank you so much.
On this note, I may invite Sachin. I'm sure Sachin is going to give us a very broad picture of the leadership position and how the leadership are taking care of this scenario, the risk scenario or the crisis scenario, and how they are gathering, how they are looking into it. Sachin, if you can give us some insight that how your company, how the board or how the leadership is looking toward this crisis for the purpose of identification or mitigation. Over to you, Sachin.
Yeah, thanks, Manoj, and I really appreciate your introduction. It was very well introduced about the topic, about the current situations, which globally is there, and as well as the corporate sector, which is facing. And it's right to say that it's a, somebody said it's a black swan event. It was not an event which was known to the, anybody, you know, was known to it. It's a black swan, real black swan, and they say it's a 200-year event. 1988 pandemic was a pandemic, but this is not only a pandemic. It is a pandemic plus global recession, which is coupled with a lot of lockdowns across the globe, a lot of policy changes across the globe. Corporates are getting exposed to the situation which they never thought of. I feel nobody in the world, no corporation in the world has ever imagined a risk of these kind of pandemic. We had always imagined the risk of pandemic. It is not new. You know, year back or so, we had a Ebola, or you had a bird flu, or you have a swine flu-like event also. But those events also never resulted in such a catastrophe which the world is facing. I mean, you see all across the globe, it is hardly any, besides Africa, I feel, any continent which is not affected with this pandemic. And when you have such a major pandemic affecting the entire globe, it is very difficult to come up with the what you call BCP, business continuity plan, so quickly, because you never thought of such thing. You know, the businesses are shut down, the movement is stopped, and you are just focusing on your daily bread and butter situation. You are not going out. So nobody has imagined such situation in the world, rather, I would say. And it's, let us accept with a pinch of salt that nobody was prepared also, whether it is corporate, whether it is government, whether it is, I mean, you can see the strongest country in the world, America. I mean, it's, they are struggling. They are struggling with the life. They are struggling with the economy. They are struggling with everything. I mean, you see Europe, you see many countries, they are actually struggling. I mean, but I have one view that Europe, if you see as compared to other countries, what they did is that they first focused on the life of a people, then the economy. That is very important. India has reacted to this pandemic in the March, started reacting to the March. The first lockdown was announced, then it got extended. And if you see the graph, when the lockdown was announced, the cases was hardly 100 or 1,000 cases, not even 1,000, hundreds cases in a day. We are in the mid of August, and we are seeing 70,000 cases per day, live cases coming, and we are opening up the economy. So it's like, you know, we have put in the lockdown at a time when we were not knowing this kind of problem. Now we know this problem. What is this problem? What could be a methodology to control it? So India has did a good, I can say, move towards that, putting the lockdown, understanding the disease, and then now slowly opening up the economy. Now, you have seen many rating houses, many houses have come up with the predictions of what would be the global economy. India will be down by, there are somebody saying -2%, somebody is saying -6% GDP. You know, it will be only after the March 2021, you will get to know what is the real impact on the economy. But one thing is very clear. If you are running your company at a 33% capacity or a 10% capacity, I'm sure it's not going to be -6%. It's going to be more than that. Many corporate houses are seeing that it would be, you know, 20% to 25% loss as compared to FY 1920. Now, if you have such picture in front of you, and when you got this picture, it's very important. This picture was not there in the 15th March board meeting. I tell you, 15th March, the board meeting, which across the India, they finalized their annual business plan for next year. Nobody has thought of that. You know, the business plan, which I'm making on 15th of March, within a week's time, I need to relook it. And everybody must have faced it. You see, SEBI has actually got a request that can you can you allow us to club our quarterly reporting? We can't show our result for quarterly. We can show our result half yearly. So which shows that what fear the business houses are having. They have no picture to show what they anticipate for the year to come. And when you have such situation, there is a test of leadership come. I feel when you say about a corporate governance, it's about managing the four things. It's about people, it's about rule, it's about process, and it's about procedures. If you're able to manage this four thing, then it's a pure corporate governance. And when it comes to corporate governance, all eyes goes towards the board of director. Why board of directors are very important? See, I belong to a group which has a history of one of the most respected company in the India, as also one of the most respected company in the world, Tata, House of Tata. If you have heard the interview of Mr. Ratan Tata a few days back on Your Story channel, he said one thing, the corporate leaders should have avoided removing their labels. It was a very sensitive and very heart-touching statement. Why he said that? The laborers or the workers who stood by you in ups and down of business and in such pandemic, if you are asking them to go, let me tell you, after 1 year, when the time will come, they will also give you the same touch what you'd give them today. So it's very important what is the tone of a top and who sets this tone of the top. It is set by the board of director. So when you have a culture or when you have a strong board of director, which has set at the highest level that, listen guys, okay, we are facing the worst phase in the history of their own or the company. But you know one thing, we are not going to fire the people. It may happen that we will take no increment. It may happen that people will take no promotions this year, but we are not going to fire you. We are not going to let you go. You are with us. You know, it's very important message. We all say that, a company is not only about shareholder. Company has various stakeholder, and employees is one of the very strong stakeholder. You can't run a company. What do you mean by company? Company is not a sole proprietorship. It's about the association of people. It's about the people who are with you, whether it is a top management, whether it is a senior middle management or to the lower management. So it's very important that board of directors sets the tone of the top. And if they set these kind of words that, listen guys, you are safe in the company. We're not going to fire you. We are having a tough time. We will not going to give you the promotion increment this year, but you are safe this year. You need to work on how to get a business. It gives you a comfort that, okay, let us come together. Then come next step, how to come out of it. In last 4 or 5 months, I tell you, each and every company in the India must have seen not less than 4 to 5 board meetings. Just imagine in 3 months, you are having 4 or 5 board meetings, which is not normal. Why? Because the directors are concerned that how to make this company sustainable, because a business has to be sustainable. You can't just run a business on an unsustainable method. When you rightly said, Manoj, in the March, when the government MHA has issued the circular of 24th of March, and it made obligation on an employer that you have to pay salary, you can't remove people. It's good. It's really good. But what after that? What are you doing to make this corporate sustainable? Then on the representation of the various corporate houses and the association, on May 13 to May 17, there was series of announcement, financial packages, Atmanirbhar Bharat, then MSMEs, and many things came up. Now slowly we are coming to stabilization. The board has somewhere across the India has taken this with a pinch of salt that this year we have to take 10 to 20% lesser target as compared to last year. We don't have to give promotion increment this year. We have to connect with our customers. We have to reduce our rates. We have to give them comfort that, we are with you. We are going to give you the support. We have to come to the table discussion with our contractor that, listen, guys, it may happen that, your payment get be delayed, but we will pay you. These kind of things, if management sit across the table, give the confidence, it's very important. The supply chain should run. If the board of directors are strong or the company is strong enough with the values which they work upon, I tell you, within a year, India will stand again. And India has a very bright chance to stand again. It's one of the fastest moving economy. And with the population of 130 crore, I'm sure that each and every individual has aspirations. And those aspirations will be protected. And I feel that it's maybe somewhere in the Q3 or Q4, you will see the revival in the economy. The pictures will be much clearer. That's what I would say.
Thank you. Thank you, Sachin, very much. I mean, definitely, it's a very optimistic and hopeful forecast you are giving. And yes, I mean, I'm in agreement with you. Only thing is, there are some noise by the WHO, and or they're raising this, that there can be a relapse issues in the corona, and it may come back. The so-called herd immunity, which is developing, it can go away in a shorter span, and this antibody development in the plasma of the people who are already infected may not be permanent. So there are different kind of scenarios also coming, but I am equally hopeful as you are. In fact, there is another situation. I mean, forecasting in the past was not possible for such an event. I am in complete agreement with you. No model is there which can forecast such an event. But when you are in the middle of the event, I mean, I would like to turn to Devolina, that how at your end, Devolina, in your company, I mean, you are already a leader in your company in a position, and your board, how you people, I mean, evaluated the potential disruption to the operations and business relationship. I'm posing this question to you, keeping in mind that definitely for the pharmaceutical company, there was some initial disruption, but at the same time, there was a kind of an opportunity also for invention, innovation, and then there are a certain regulatory regime across the globe we are hearing has been put in place by the government. So what is your view, Devolina, on the evaluation of the potential disruption in the beginning, and now how you are feeling when we are 6 months older within the COVID era? Over to you, Devolina.
Thank you, Manoj, and good day, everyone. I heard Sachin, and it was, you know, it was really very heartfelt. Pharma and healthcare took a little different way to address the pandemic, because, you know, we were like a dam. So it hit us first. And how do we, you know, prevent a flood? Or, you know, release the water slowly. So that was something, you know, which pharma and healthcare had to face. It was right in the front of the brunt. And the models we saw in pharma and healthcare were primarily twofold. One being a research-oriented model, which the companies went into. The other one were different commercial models like joint ventures, research agreements, clinical trial agreements, and M&As, of course. So there has been, in fact, I can say in the pharma space, the M&As have been more in numbers compared to the M&As in the other industry. Many have even they have broken up and they are into arbitrations and litigations, but pharma M&As have been quite successful. I won't say they were easy to finish, but they were successful because that was the hour of the need. Plus research. I think today every pharma company is into the research of three things. One is the vaccine. Second one is the antivirals. And third ones are supplementary doses, like, you know, which are life supporting. For instance, the medical kits, the PPE kits, the dexamethasone, the steroids. So there are a lot of joint ventures in these areas. Plus, there are researches on the vaccine. So a lot of companies have entered into CMO arrangements, which is contract manufacturing arrangements for manufacturing of vaccines, clinical trials arrangements in the vaccines. And of course, you know, for the antivirals and the antibiotics, there are huge ventures. Like, you know, one example I can give you, which is already in the public domain, is the Gilead's drug, which is remdesivir. It has, I think, in India itself, there are about 5 companies who have entered into ventures. So I think pharma took this step very early, right? You know, maybe even before February. So it had an anticipation, it saw the opportunity, and the legal departments got very busy at that time. As far as the challenges which other than pharma, the healthcare faced, as well as pharma faced, was actually in the supply chain. So though we were working, you know, we didn't get this, though we had work from home, but it was not always possible to do work from home. We had to be on the shop floor. But what really impacted was the supply chain and the distribution channel, because that went berserk. You know, you did manufacture, but then how do you distribute it, you know? So though there were exceptions to all the government notifications on the lockdown, you know, which came post March 23rd, but actually you didn't have the transport system to deliver. So that's why we felt we had a lot of challenges and a lot of disputes also. So again, you know, as in-house counsels, we had to support business in those areas. And of course, you know, finally, there is a lot of progress made in the healthcare system as well as in the hospitals, though, you know, we are overcrowded with a lot of notifications and, you know, price regulations and all. But we are coping up, because all said and done, the philosophy of a pharma and a healthcare organization is, you know, safety first, availability second, and, you know, then everything follows. Of course, not undermining your profits or whatever, but we never, or I don't think any pharma company, the board or anyone would have that philosophy to undermine safety and availability. So we have raised, you know, to raising to the bar, and we have come out and faced these challenges. And yes, I have also heard of relapses, that there could be relapses, but yes, there's a lot of work going on so that, you know, our institutions, whether be the hospitals or the, you know, the supply of drugs, we will try to match up. And yes, today they say, you know, doctors are the most needed and the most, you know, venerable community. So yeah, much.
Thank you, Debalina. Thank you for the great insight and input. And yes, I can see what you're saying. The, perhaps the business disruption, except the supply chain, was not of the same level or same magnitude in the case of the pharmaceutical company, because of the new invention, innovativeness was required, and new drug excise started very early, and everybody sensed it. All the big pharma companies like yours sensed it. So I can see what you're saying. So disruption strategy could be different for the regular infrastructure companies and for the pharma companies. And that is very interesting take I'm taking today, Debalina. Thank you very much.
Manoj, can I add something to what Debalina said?
Yes, please.
Manoj, see, also what was interesting was Debalina touched upon the opportunities of takeover and opportunities for acquisitions, right? See, it played differently on different players, depending on which side were you, right? While I think what this pandemic caused also was suppression of the valuations all across the board. The companies were having very, very low valuations, and I think SEBI had to even come in to kind of step in to stop some of those predatory behaviors. And that was, again, what I saw was also some of the responsibilities or the caution that boards were required to take during these times, right? That they are not at the receiving end of some of these takeover bids and things like that. We didn't see too many, but then the takeover market was quite active. And this was, I think, the board responsibility also to create a oversight. And similarly, Sachin kind of touched upon the executive compensation matters, right? So those are also both ways in terms of the long-term effect of those compensation decisions, and also in terms of immediately, because at the higher level, many of these compensation decisions which companies took And the senior management, as you know, have many of their salaries linked to performance, right? The performance dipped or the compensation decisions were taken, which were on the south side, that would impact the long-term takeaway and some of the motivation levels of the senior executives as well. So my limited point here was that this pandemic was, one, we could not predict it. Second, it played out differently on different players, depending on which point of the value chain or which side of the value chain you were.
I got it. Yeah, Anubhav, I'm in complete agreement.
Manoj, just one thing. Anubhav, you're right. But as far as, you know, SEBI's actions, I think listed companies, you know, we have the responsibility. And there were special SEBI regulations. There was a notification by SEBI on COVID disclosures, you know, that if whether it's a transaction or, you know, sudden extreme dip in business, the companies were allowed to disclose that to SEBI. So I think listed companies were very cautious. But yes, you know, in terms of a few, you know, there are always, you know, there's always a cat amongst the pigeons, you know. So yes, you do have such cases. But valuations were very maverick. They were very maverick. I do agree. And people, depending on which side you are, seller or purchaser, you had to walk that extra mile.
Yeah, Devalina, thank you very much. I mean, this is very interesting. And the point Anubhav was bringing in, I mean, that is very interesting. So risk mitigation is one thing, what you are doing of your own. In fact, I want to go back to Jitender on this aspect because I know he's having a huge, huge experience in the government regulatory affair. Jitender, I would like to understand from you, I mean, definitely the firms, the companies has taken their own risk mitigation steps. But how you look at the government actions or the government notifications per se in general? I mean, SEBI disclosure that we should disclose, all the listed companies should disclose that what is the cost implication on the balance sheet of the companies. That is absolutely clear. And SEBI has also termed it as unforeseen circumstances. The disclosure start with the word the unforeseen COVID. So how, Jitender, you look at the scenario towards risk mitigation and the role of the government who are the same? Over to you, Jitender.
Yeah, thank you very much, Manoj. That's very much relevant in today's scenario that, you know, when this kind of a uncertain situation has arisen, so the role of the government is also become very challenging. You know, what kind of guidelines they should issue in this situation so that it will take care of the people aspect as well as, you know, the corporate also. They need to manage both the things. So that is why when we look at, you know, the guidelines which has been issued by the government, these guidelines to some extent, you know, are very balanced in nature in terms of making sure that even the economic activities to some extent should also continue. So under that situation, if I look at the corporate level, you know, there are various guidelines. And I recall a situation where, you know, I was part of one of the group where we just keep, looking forward to these guidelines and analyze that, you know, what all can be done now and what best can be advised to the company or to the management so that, you know, they can take some economic activities forward. So, you know, analyzing that aspect that, you know, how I can advise the business so that they can start some bit of operation. So for example, I belong to a cosmetic industry, right? So there, when you know, the guidelines came and some relaxation was given, it only talks about that, yes, some essential, activities or economic activities can be done, but without defining, you know, very clearly what exactly is, you know, the essential services actually include. So there we really need to, use our interpretation in a way that it will take care of the guidelines as well at the same time, making sure that the corporate should still make some, you know, efforts and do some activities. So, there was not too much of a, if I look at, you know, the government regulation, so they have not provided too much of a window where we can see clarification on, okay, what all can be done, what all cannot be done. So, you know, making sure that, you know, under this situation, how we really interpret those guidelines so that the business can be served better. So that is one aspect. And another aspect of the risk management, you know, I just heard from Anubhav and even Sachin also touched upon that point of compensation. So, I mean, of course, there's a lot of cost pressure on all the companies in today's time. And a lot of, you know, companies are taking measure how they can really manage the compensation part. So this pandemic situation has really, you know, make even the management and the professional very innovative. So they are coming up with very innovative solution also to that. So, you know, for example, one of the situation regarding compensation, the way it has been managed in our company was like, instead of, you know, cutting the salary, so we come out with a plan that, okay, let's employee pledge their timing. So in this situation, okay, you be with your family, or if you want to really spend more time with family in this situation, so you can pledge your some of the days, for example, you know, 1 day in a week or 2 days in a week, and accordingly to that extent, you will be, you know, you can take off, and the compensation will be then, it will be without any compensation. So, you know, and then you are pledging your, let's say 1 month or 2 months salary and taking once in a week off. So it is not straight away cut in the remuneration, but at the same time, the way it has been, you know, told to the employee was as if you are helping the company by pledging your time, and then similarly making sure that the compensation pressure on the organization is also taken care of. So apart from this, you know, if I purely talk about, you know, the regulatory aspect of the things, so, you know, if you look at the MHA guidelines also, so these guidelines keep changing, and how, you know, swiftly we, you know, get hold of those guidelines and then make corrective action and suggest to the board of director that, you know, this is, or maybe to the management who all is taking the decision for running the organization. So that really determines that, you know, how fast we can reach out to the management. And, you know, because, you know, if you look at the guidelines also, after some time, it becomes very state specific also. So state government also have their own, you know, guidelines on top of what MHA is issuing. So I think what really matters is that how fast we can analyze those guidelines and reach out to our management and suggest, you know, the corrective action which can be taken at that time.
Yeah.
Manoj, if may I just add to Jitendra's point, you know, this guideline, it's very, very interesting to note. I mean, you know, there must be thousands of guidelines in the India on COVID specific, be it central government, be it state governments. You see, it's, I was actually reading one of the article, you know, Singapore has one guideline. They made one law. And in that, you everything is covered. I mean, somewhere when it comes to the life of people, we should just come out of the stigma of central government list or the state government list. Let us come and let us see what should be the guidance. You know, that's something I feel if would have been managed. You know, if I go to the one website, which is called India COVID-19, it has guidance for the corporates, it has guidance for the hospitals, it has guidance for the travelers, it has guidance for everything. I think that could have made the life easier. Today, you have to actually struggle. You know, if somebody has to say that, boss, mujhe jo hai, I have to go to the Pune, then I need to say what is the Pune guidance. I need to go see what is the Mumbai guidance. You know, that's something if could have been, I feel could have been managed better.
Thank you. Thank you, Sachin.
You actually make a good point. And while I think the government did a fabulous job, I would say in terms of reacting, right, what we were very closely working with the PMO and there were, this time what we saw was a very data centric approach, and the guidelines were also given timely. But what you highlighted in terms of the state and the union is a very valid point, right? At the end of it, we all got lost into the state and district level guidances. But also see, it touches upon a very core issue of, do we have the regulatory framework in place, right? The act on which the government was framing those guidelines was a 200-year-old act, which was basically done to avoid a bubonic plague that happened in the city of, or the state of Bombay, right? And it was structured, the clause 2 of the Epidemic Act only talks about how they can limit the movement of people, right? What this epidemic brought out was that that is only a little part about how to solve the larger issues that we saw in the recent epidemic or pandemic. Then these issues were all across. They were ethical issues. They were issues related to access to health care. They were issues in terms of what happens to the marginal class in the society. It was about what is the behavior of the corporates in such a scenario. It bordered around issues of regulatory culture, which I think the regulations fell short. Right. I understand there is a national health bill that has been languishing, which touches all this aspects of epidemic or modern day crisis management in case of a healthcare situation. But certainly we felt that the regulatory framework available fell short to address many of those issues in the present times. I think it was more response based on the
regular. Anubhav, thank you very much for this. You're very right. I mean, the way Sachin also pointed out, and but you know, there is a just for the record, Government of India has attempted it. There is a one website. I mean, there's a one website where they have collated all the COVID-19 notification. It is there. Yes. And number one, number two, definitely response could have been better. But some of the notifications in essential commodities, if you see, there is a notification for the power, there is a notification for the solar. They tried to put the notification in place so that the solar power producer or the thermal power producer should keep on getting the some money. There is a regulation for 50% and there is a regulation for 100%. Then they've identified certain industries as the essential commodity. For port, for continuance of business, they have taken out certain things. For mines, they have started taken out certain things. I'm not saying there are, I'm taking Jitendra point that there must be, that is a very good point I'm taking to taking back today, that the window to further suggest, negotiate, or give the input is missing. That is a point which is very valid. Otherwise, there are certain, some serious attempt. There could have been a one attempt also, like in a US for the banking channel, there is an attempt that how the institutions can reach to the federal government for the financial help. We have a different kind of scenario here, despite of the, with due respect of, to the RBI, despite of their clear-cut guidelines 27th March onward, is still the different banks are treating for the expansion of working capital different client differently. So there is a no clear-cut guideline. So it is again, it lead to certain kind of discretion. Discretion is good and bad both. Today we are not finding the reason for it. I have to go back to on a detail, one issue which I want to touch, for which I will go back to Mohit. But before that, Anubhav, if you can also give us some idea, because I mean, my this question to you leads to the larger input from Mohit also. So how in your business, you have planned or the board have planned for the continuity in business, keeping a risk in mind, because risk is there now. We all are knowing post 23, 24, 25 months that risk is there. How you people plan the continuity of the business within your organization? If you can give some, share your experience, I think it will be very helpful for the organization, for everybody here sitting here.
Yeah, you know, a couple of things that I wanted to essentially talk about in terms of continuity of business has been the very interesting need that came to the fore very quickly, I think, for a lot of industries and a lot of organizations, which is basically the fact that your resilience plans were probably being tested in the most torrid way. Probably for the first time that we've seen in our lives. So all of us have resilience plans, all of us have BCP. The interesting things that came out of this particular situation was probably the suddenness with which things had to kick in and how it could essentially lead to a fair amount of what I would describe as the last mile run to get things in place. And that last mile run was a very interesting juxtaposition of what was coming out in terms of national guidelines, advisory, state response and local administrative response for the right reasons. But given the suddenness, I think what it tested was how prepared are you in the face of a complete lockdown, which not only locks you out of your offices, not only locks you out of access to equipment, and I think starkly brings to the fore how prepared are employees really in their own domestic domains to be able to step up and do what they do very easily in the office. So in terms of this last minute, the last mile rush, the scramble to cover all of this and cover it appropriately and rightly, and mind you, I think we've also talked about people very, 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 very correctly in this process. How do you also deal with the fear and the anxiety in people in terms of, can I even come in for 10 minutes to pick up something which is basically work-related? So if I need a laptop, if I need a dongle, if I need something, should I really come in? What is it going to do to me? What is it going to do to my family? How am I protected? And I think that's the very interesting balance that came out from the people side. Of course, you know, the imperative being that we have a business to do, we have customers to serve, and we can't let the system collapse. What's the right balance in terms of then looking to take stock of who has what in terms of resource? And how do we then quickly move to cover the gap in terms of that resource to make sure that there is minimal interruption and disruption? And then as you move to do that, interesting conversations arise in terms of how do you make sure that what you're planning to do does not therefore end up unwittingly creating consequences in terms of privacy, in terms of cybersecurity, in terms of the right kind of software, the right kind of equipment. So very interesting splicing and dicing of the number of factors that had to, I think, at a simultaneous point of time come rushing through the pipes. You know, it can be overwhelming. And in that sense of overwhelming, how do you find that right kind of balance to be able to plan, resource, make sure that your continuum is maintained? You'll remember, all of us remember in the early days as the first national lockdown guidelines came into place and administrations in local areas were also reacting to the local situation in terms of, you know, more drastic measures, more drastic curtailment of movement. How do you essentially allow the basic movement of the necessary goods and people, even if they're not the people who are frontline, the support people, to be able to bring all that together, right? And then how do you apply permissions? What's the appropriate way to go about it? How do you talk to the police? How do you talk to the district authorities? What kind of industry approach do you need? And when you talk about an industry approach, yes, we are largely, all of us, I think, when you talk about industry verticals, we're all there fitting into industry verticals, but we're not the same, right? So each one of us will have a different need. Each one of us will have something else to look to. And rightfully, the authorities were also responding, everybody wants something else, right? So if an authority turns around and says, I don't think more than 10 people should be available to you in a particular location at a particular time, a company could turn around and say, but you know, for my essential work, I need 100. And that's a classic face-off in terms of what's the right balance. So when you step back from this melee and this confusion to start to plan in terms of what's appropriate and what's right, from a continuity procedure, to be able to do your business, you're faced with all of this and it takes time to settle down. It must, you know, any ship that's sailing in a particular direction, if you suddenly need to slow down, turn it around, it takes time. And that's, I think, something that all industries have had to tackle. And all industries have had to tackle in terms of not only making sure that they've planned in a very, very quick order to be able to provide the necessary equipment and the infrastructure, to assess who has what, to assess who needs what, to step in, therefore, to make those supplies, and take into account a whole slew of other things in terms of cybersecurity, data privacy, how are you dealing with information, in industries where information is important in terms of working from an environment that's not safe, how you're working with data, you know, through lines of connectivity which are not necessarily secure, and how you're therefore dealing with all the risk factors that associate with everything. So it's not just basically rushing in to fill in that void to allow continuum. It's also at the same time racing in to try and, you know, contain all of the attendant risk. Now, that's one aspect of the business. The other aspect of the business, as you sit down to think about what do you do when you interact with customers transactionally, is to realize that you may have an umbrella BCP, but actually when it comes down to a situation like this, you will discover that almost every particular product or structure or transaction will need a specific BCP tweak. And then you look at the whole, you know, and particularly as legal functions, as fraud functions, as other control functions, you sit back and look at everything that we need to put together for every potential tweak of structure, product, transaction in terms of what's the right fit for BCP. And you will end up with BCP, which is, well, in its primary structure, fairly similar. But in every line of business, you're having to actually deal with the tweaks and the differentiation which addresses that particular customer set or that particular product. So it is very busy in terms of just making sure that all of this gets put together in a very, very quick and short order of time. But also, as you go along, and as all of us have realized, when you look at the time frame, it's been 1 month, then 2 months, then 3 months, now five, and we don't quite know when we will come back to normalcy. How do you sort of look at the situation in terms of BCP, in terms of continuity, towards assessing what continues to be right, towards assessing the fact that at some point of time you're going to come back to normalcy? Are you missing something in terms of what you will need to take stock of when things become normal? And are you also planning to make sure that everything that you're doing in terms of BCP today, in terms of whether they are relaxations or whether they're alternative modes of doing business, everything that gets put aside potentially from the point of view that this is not possible to implement in a time like this, are you also taking stock of what you will need to do to make sure all of that comes back and is put back into your systems once you come to normalcy and once you come to what is going to happen once this comes to a halt and we're looking at a normal world where people might potentially be in trouble and where you might potentially also not have the umbrella frameworks of relaxations, moratoriums that have come in from a regulatory space in order to make sure that things continue to run. But when all of this comes to a halt, then are you also looking to the future in terms of what you need to do to be future ready to deal with the fallout? Not only, as I said, of bringing things back to normal, making sure that everything that was not being done in the normal way has been planned for so that all of those things can be plugged, but also to look at what happens in the future in terms of disputes, in terms of force majeure, in terms of just sheer inability that people may have to be able to address their exposures. What do you do then? So, and all of this is obviously also in the continuum of everything that the government and the regulators have relaxed as of this point of time and put in as temporary measures. But will they continue? Will they also have a life cycle of their own in terms of the canvas that the government and the regulators are looking at in terms of the future in the short term? And in that future in the short term, as they look at it, will industry necessarily be looking at it in the same way? Or do they need to plan for fallback? All of this, I think, has thrown up a very interesting schematic of continued work in progress in terms of just containing risk, making sure you're responding in the right way to employees, making sure you're responding in the right way to organizational need, and making sure you're responding to customer, and eventually also making sure that you run a business, because that's eventually what you're here to do as well. Yep. So that everything doesn't come to a grinding halt.
Thank you, Mohit. Thank you. It's a really very, very holistic thought process, I would say. And it's a very leadership thought process. I mean, I'm very delighted to hear you holistically that how it should be. We should consider the situation which way. I'm in complete agreement. I have a couple of quick fire questions, which we will come after the one question to Anubhav precisely. Anubhav, can you also share with us tactically for the, we have heard yours and all the panelists' view on the overall scenario. Just as a matter of a case study, I mean, at your end, in your company, for the business continuity, which steps you have taken? And is there any regulatory issue which you are facing so that on the legal leadership, the audience can be benefited today by your input, which you have implemented? Over to you, Anubhav.
Thank you, Manoj. I think I'll take what Mohit kind of alluded to and touched on the many aspects of what changed during the sudden lockdown that we were stuck, right, when the first notification came. So I think what we did in terms of a strategy can be summarized in three letters, what we called it as a COC, right? The first C was about a crisis management, which basically was about creating a multi-stakeholder, multi-resource group as the core team, which would address the different issues and take decisions which came with the lockdown announcements and the spread of the disease. Because as you know, when the first notification hit us, everything came to a grinding stop, right? And obviously the factory environment that we work in, even these factories cannot be stopped. As Mohit rightly said, it requires even a week or 15 days to even stop these factories, which are running at a global capacity. And some of these also require continuous maintenance, right? So this was not an easy task that it could very well be easily synchronized, but we had to also obey the regulation. The second part of the strategy, so we had this crisis team who was looking into the different aspects. They were prioritizing the different issues that they came in, and depending on the seriousness, the priority, different decisions were taken by this core committee. And this committee had people from the operations, the legal team was representatives were there. The medical representatives were there. We had representatives from supply chain organizations. We had representatives even from health and safety sitting on this MRG, who was taking these crucial decisions, and it continues to be there even now. The second part of that COC was oversight, right? So the crisis management team then delegated the responsibility into certain oversight teams. Say, for example, we had one core team which was looking at operations, right, including supply chain, including transportation, including imports and exports. And there were all kind of stuff happening everywhere. It was impossible for a certain set of people to address all the things. There was one regulatory team that we had, on a legal regulatory, where we had right presentations, which was processing all the notifications that were coming to us day in, day out, and also liaising with at the local level, because our plants are spread at, we have 22 plants, so spread all over the country in different states, at least 6 or 7 states, and every state was addressing it differently. And the last of the COC is the communication piece, right? This was the most important piece for us, because whatever we did, there was an anxiety with everyone, right? Nobody, while there was so much on the social media and in the public domain, I think what was also very pivotal and important for us is how we communicate to our stakeholders, including employees, the government officials, our suppliers. So this consisted of our PR or the government relations team, and also our communication teams and HR, which constantly stayed in touch with our stakeholders. Now, obviously, the heavy, and I think this was the combination of a three-pronged strategy that helped us go through it. But I must tell you, there were like five streams in the O that we were focusing on. I think the first was people. There were a whole lot of issues that we had to address with respect to both white collar and blue collar workers. We had to take several steps in terms of not only addressing the immediate issue of labor, but also in terms of, as the lockdown eased out, how do we start our factories and ensure their health and safety? Then there was this whole issue of supply and demand, right? While the supply chains were all disrupted and many of our suppliers who were severely affected, we did come to and rescued them. We worked with them to restore their supplies, restore their manpower, give them the required credit or support that they required. So the second important stuff was about supply and also the demand of it, because we still had certain contracts on export commitments that we had to meet. Or since we are into power generation and engines, we were also supporting some of the essential services like hospitals and railways and electric companies. So we had to continue many of those support to just help them cope up with the emerging situation. I think the more, and then there was this whole issue of cost and cash, right? As this was one board responsibility, but it was also a responsibility of the senior management, because clearly what we could see is that the markets are going to change, be disrupted because of the COVID. And so there was a stream which was working on different measures on both cost and cash. But also there was a very important committee among these five committees that we had, and that was the community or the CSR committee. I think not only while we were managing our disruptions at the business level, there was a team within the company who was day in, day out working in terms of how do we support the communities, how do we work with the administration to kind of help them manage the people who were really in trouble, were the affected people. They were not, the healthcare facilities were not at the best of health. In fact, there were a scarcity of sanitizers and even face masks. So the company kind of through the CSR worked extremely well with the community and the local officers to manage the situation at the community level. In fact, later, even now, we have set up now plants actually to manufacture masks and sanitizers, not only to meet our internal demand, but also to give it the stuff away to the community. So that was broadly the strategy. There are many nuances to it. Say, for example, on supply chain, one of the biggest lessons that we moved almost strategically from, say, just in supply to just in case strategy, right? It is okay that you have all your suppliers in one go and you nurture those suppliers, but there is a dependency. You never know how your supply chain is going to get affected through an event like pandemic. So there was a sudden need that you got to have alternate suppliers as well, where these events can happen, right? So I think those are the shades of different things that we did. And as Mohit rightly pointed out, not only it was about managing the crisis, but also it was about what happens when we open up. What is the situation in the new normal? How are we going to behave differently or going to cope up with the situation in the new normal as the disease or the pandemic eases out, right? So those are some of the themes I can bring to the table at this point, and I can dive deep into each one of them, but at a broad level, COC is what I would summarize our
study. Thank you. Yeah, Anubha, thank you very much. It was very insightful, and thank you very much for this. And pandemic, I agree with you, is creating a different kind of situation on day-to-day basis. It is a dynamic. It is not a static situation. It is dynamic. And see the dynamism. See the wonderful dynamism, gentlemen, and all the friends here. I mean, the pandemic has brought most of us working from home. And hence, exposing what? Exposing our data, leaving the server, leaving the office, leaving going to the third party. And from third party, it may going to the fourth party, clients of clients. Now, this data, when leaving the internal company database, then what are the security threats? How to deal with those security threats? What are the mechanism? Data is the new economy. You know, if I may say, especially in the cases of some of the companies which I know, the Debelina pharmaceutical company or the Sachin consulting engineering company, there can be tendering data, there can be 50,000 kind of data which can be sensitive and which may have a business value, which may have a financial value. Now, how to control that data? So this dynamism has come to the next level. I mean, VPN and then VPN, then there is a click VPN. If there is a click VPN, when data is not transferring, somebody is only having impression, still it can be recorded or not. I mean, and then VPN and a whole of the data we should put where? We should put on the gateway of the Azure, Windows, again it is going somewhere else. If we are putting at our own end, putting a server, again we are throwing it through some gateway, again somebody is looking at my data. Now, is it also bringing in the openness, which is desired or not desired? It is bringing the other challenges, which are critical or not critical? I don't know. I don't have ready-made answer to it. But this all required need to be seen into. I mean, definitely companies need to have a set up a very, very strict protocol where their data, client data, other confidential information, documents remain protected during the period. The year has not been a great year for the businesses. The year has not been a fair to, I mean, if you ask me, not a fair year at all, but it's a catch 22. And the one hand, as Jitender aptly pointed out, and Sachin was echoing the same thing also, that where is the mechanism when somebody is hearing us on the protocol preparation? Somebody should hear us. I mean, what we require to run this show. I mean, if you are not hearing and you're putting a regulatory regime, which I may require, I may not require, then what to do next? So there will be a constant need for developing. There is a constant need for evolving. There is a constant need for planning. And in the interest of time, if I may end up this session, I mean, this is the time when the definition of the planning is most important to me. You know, it is a time when planning can be put at the best. And it reminds me, Nobel laureate Amartya Sen, who has said that planning is nothing but prioritization of resources. And perhaps this COVID, this emergency time, this crisis time is the time when we can put this definition to the best of its use, gentlemen. Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all the panelists and the audience. And I'm sure we will come out of this crisis situation very soon. And the leaders like the esteemed panelists are going to give their input for the organization, for the society per se. And we will evolve from here. India will be much shiner post-COVID. I'm sure about it. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Manoj.
Thank you.
Thank you, Manoj.